new disability seminar series are Stoughty and precariousness. So this is hopefully the first of a number of series running, or number of seminars running over the coming year. And really the first launch in some ways of the displaces theme within the School of Education and Social Work. I'm looking around, there are many familiar faces, but there's some unfamiliar faces. Are you from University of Dundee? Or
Yeah, from psychology.
Psychology. Anybody else that I don't?
Duncan Jordanstone.
Okay, so we're Dundee based. Okay, lovely. So we're fortunate this afternoon to start with two guest speakers from Malmö University in Sweden, Maria and Elizabeth. Original advertising that went out, we were going to have Marianne from Germany too, but she unfortunately hasn't been able to come. And Fiona has stepped in, Fiona Campbell down here, has stepped in to replace Marianne for today's seminar. But hopefully Marianne will be joining us at some point during the year. So the structure of this afternoon is we have over 3 hours, which is great. And I think speakers will be speaking for around half an hour, 45 minutes each. And I'm going to restrict them to 45 minutes each. Depending on when they finish, we'll determine whether we have time for questions after each speaker. Hopefully we'll have a little bit of time after each speaker. But then around half an hour at the end for general discussion and questions. We're lucky enough to have some catering. So we'll take a break. I think after the first two speakers, we have Maria first, and then Fiona, and I think then we'll take a short 10-15 minute break, tea, coffee, cakes, toilets, whatever is needed, and then we'll have Elizabeth, and then time for the questions. Okay, so we'll get started with Maria first. Yeah, so thank you very much. You want to introduce yourself rather than me? And we have lots of information that Fiona's been busy coordinating, and we're coordinating a whole sort of seminar series, we should say. But information about the speakers and the displaces research theme in the lovely. Yep. Okay, thank you.
I'm Marianne Nustedt from Malmö University. I'm a senior lecturer at the Department of Social Work. And what I'll do today is that I will present some of my findings from a recently finished study about hidden or invisible impairments in work. And I will focus on the empirical findings. And this study focused both on experiences of the individuals and what I would call representatives of the employers, and I will get back to who they are in a minute. And it's both about institutional practices and discourses in working life, as well as the experiences of people with invisible impairments. And this interest of mine about invisible impairments spring from my dissertation, which was on work and stroke and the return to working life after a stroke, where many of the informants told me that it was the things that others couldn't see, the hidden disabilities, that was the problem, not what others could see. And that made me think or wonder if this could be relevant also to other impairments, or if it was a general difference between what can be seen and what can't be seen. And with invisible impairments, this is a quote from Matthews and Harrington, but they talk about invisible disabilities. I refer to invisible impairments as something that are either invisible for others because they can't be visibly seen on the body, or because the person is actively hiding it through various strategies. So that's what I mean when I talk about invisible impairments. And the most characteristic thing about visible impairments, is that how it is up to the person themselves to decide to whom, when, and how to disclose. And Goffman's theoretical concept of passing is often used to frame this, a common way to frame this possibility or privilege to pass as normal. But this privilege can also, as some researchers have pointed out, contain negative emotions such as shame or for not acknowledging who you actually are. And Samuels, for example, talks about an inner dissonance. And invisibility can be an important concept here that can contribute to discussions on identity within disability studies. And researchers has also made parallels between coming out as homosexual as the same as coming out with your invisible impairments, while as others have said that there is a difference between this, what you can see and what you can't see. Whereas coming out with visible impairments might involve a kind of self-acceptance and perhaps pride in visible impairments might involve daily negotiations with others who don't trust you or questions your impairment. So this also involves dilemmas in the everyday practices in everyday life. So it's not just a question of identity, but actually practices in everyday life. And what earlier studies have done is that it's not been that much research on invisible impairments. It's becoming a growing field within disability studies. But the few ones that have been made show that people with invisible impairments to a much higher degree than people with less apparent impairments sees hinders to disclose. And these hinders has to do with these kind of things. The risk of not being employed or being fired, limited chances for promotion, the worry of losing health insurance, or the worry of being treated and met as different by co-workers and employees. Also, other research has shown that the support from co-workers are also a very important factor when it comes to decisions on disclosure or non-disclosure. So the aim with my study was to identify and understand what aspects influence on persons' decisions to disclose or not to disclose. And I thought I'd just say a few words about why I use the term impairments and not disability, even though my research interest is in questions on marginalization in working life. I draw on the argument that, for example, Bill Hughes and Kevin Peterson has lifted forward when they argue that by not letting questions of impairment be taken into consideration, questions of the body tends to get invisible in disability studies. And for this study, I was inspired by institutional ethnography, as the sociologist and feminist Dorothy Smith has worked with it. And I interviewed both persons who have invisible impairments themselves, and they had MS, Parkinson's disease, bipolar syndrome, fibromyalgia, and visual impairment. And they all came from different workplaces, both public and private sector, larger and smaller workplaces, and they had what you would call white collar work or manual work, and in the service area as well. But I also interviewed, as I said, representatives of the employers. And what I mean with that is that they, in their work, in their professional role, they handled questions on disability, sick leave, rehabilitation, at different workplaces, also both in the private and the public sector. So they were both employers, managers, human resource personnel, and also one psychologist and one doctor from the occupational health service. And as I said, I refer to them as representatives of the employers. And the analysis of this empirical material has been inspired by institutional ethnography. So it focuses on what institutional practices that influence people and their decisions and their experiences. And I will talk a bit more about this methodological issues on Thursday in this PhD session that we will have as well. But these are the aspects that I've identified. Today I will only talk about these four last ones. And if there's time, I would shortly say something about how Smith's concept of work has also inspired me in the analysis. But I'll start with this first aspect of impairments, how the impairments impact on workability is one of the aspects when people decide whether they should disclose. So all of the interviews, both the persons who themselves had invisible impairments and the representatives of the employees, said that the crucial thing when disclosure was necessary was whether when the workability was affected, that's when they would have to tell their employer. And for several of the interviewees, disclosure was a necessity in order to get access to accommodation and support in the workplace or work tasks to maintain a certain workability. So these things go hand in hand. However, accommodation can also be questioned when the impairment is invisible, as I will show. And the representatives of the employers, they also saw reduced workability as the most important criteria for when an employee had to tell the employer to disclose. And this has to be understood against these laws in Sweden it's different laws and acts that are constituted to both support people with disabilities to be a part of the labor market. And it's also laws against discrimination if you have a disability or an illness. But it also is laws on the Work Environmental Act that stipulates that it's the employer's responsibility to prevent unhealthy working conditions and to adapt the work environment. And this is also something that is interesting, that an employee doesn't have to mention the diagnosis for his or her employer. They only have to tell in what way their impairment affects their workability. And interestingly also, there's this law that is mentioned within some of these about the duty to keep secret for the employer. So that paragraph gives voice to a normative assumption that illness and disability is something private and nothing one would want others to know about. And even though the incitement with these laws are to include people with disabilities in the regular labor market, and ensuring in a healthy working life, the tension in working life between needing accommodation and being perceived as productive becomes visible, especially in this interview with Anna, as I will show you now. She says, I don't want to be the one coming to work and they think, here's Anna who's ill. I want to function. I want them to treat me as normal, as everyone else. But at the same time, I want them to understand that I'm not always able. And that's really hard. That balance is really hard.
And as I see it here, Anna talks about this paradox, how she doesn't want to be treated differently because of her disability. She wants to be treated as normal. But what does normality mean in this case? And I would say that my study shows that to be normal is to work. And in Sweden there are all these different social policies that has been put into practice since the 1920s to put the unemployed into work. But the underlying principle has always been and still is that the individual should have this obligation to provide for oneself and employment for all adults. And this goal is articulated in the work strategy. And also on a European level, you recognize this, how participation in work is the main strategy for hindering marginalization of people with disabilities. But Anna do work, so participating in working life doesn't seem to be enough to be perceived or perceive herself as normal. It is when her work ability differs from her co-workers that the balance between being just like them and having certain or special needs becomes this hard balance. And she also talks about how she experienced this huge difference between working 75% and working half time. Because, as she said, working 75% is something you could do for different reasons, for parental leave or just because you want to, but to work 50% indicates that something is wrong, as she put it. And furthermore, Anna talks about her new assignments and flexible hours and how this from time to time gets questioned by her co-workers. She says, what I sometimes experience is that they have difficulties if I start at 9 instead of 8, for example, in the mornings, you get questions like, where have you been all the morning and stuff like that. Nothing sinisterly or anything. I think they forget because I don't talk about it all the time and they can't see it on me. So when Anna's co-workers perceive her as normal and can't see her reduced workability, the work distribution gets questioned in the workplace. And she feels forced to remind them and explain to them all the time. And Helen here, she also talks about her unwillingness to be treated differently. She says, there are positive and negative aspects of being different in some way. The positive thing, what you gain somehow, is that you get another kind of support and stuff like that. But the negative aspect can be that you get another treatment, that you get differently treated, and I got burnt that way at my last workplace, so I'm scared of that. This unwillingness to be seen as different can explain the hesitance that the informants had about disclosuring or concealing their impairment. And it could be explained with this quote from Manderson where disclosure is to address in some way social norms. The decision to tell of oneself is framed precisely in terms of personal consistency or discordance with normality. Diagnostic labels reflect how one might not be the same as others. It's marked different or particular, and disclosure of self, though, concerns one's difference from a given one in relation to health or any other characteristic. So this is how I see disclosure could be explained. And as I have shown, the unwillingness to be labeled as different is evident for the persons whose workability was affected by the impairment. But it's even more obvious if we talk about impairments that are understood as stigmatizing or associated with stigma. And the persons who had psychological impairments, such as bipolar type 2 or depression, were much more careful than the other persons in my study about what they actually disclosed at work. And they had much more outlined strategies of how they would tell others. For example, this became very evident when they talked about situations like an employment situation or an employment interview. And one person said, "I would never ever tell anyone I'm bipolar." And another person said, "I won't mention any diagnosis, but say that I didn't feel mentally well and went to therapy during lots of years and try to turn it into something positive." And the representatives of the employers, they had a slightly different view on whether this was impairments that was stigmatizing or not. Several of them did not perceive mental health issues as stigmatizing and refer to how much more common it was nowadays with depression or burnt out depression, and that this was like common diagnosis. They rather saw the problem with the employer knowing, but not others, like co-workers getting to know, and how they had to handle this knowledge if co-workers didn't know. But this shows that there is a discrepancy between the persons themselves, what they experience, and how the employers look upon these questions. And not only psychological impairments or are concerned with stigma, but also impairments perceived as feminine. For example, one of the male interviews, he was diagnosed with fibromyalgia, and he says, I got to know from my co-workers and team leader that I was an old lady. And also his female team leader questioned his back pain and said, she said that we should wear skirts. She didn't believe us. She reckoned we thought the work was too hard. And this shows that it's not only his masculinity and sexuality that gets questioned here, but also his will to work. And despite these experiences, this man actually chose to disclose his impairment in his new workplace. But a stigmatizing impairment could be perceived as stigmatizing also for women. One of the female interviewers said that she had chosen to disclose her impairment in order to avoid being connected to burnt out syndrome, which she thought was very common in her kind of organization in the public sector. And she was relieved to have a real diagnosis like MS to explain her workability. She didn't want to be associated with this kind of diagnosis associated to old women or the unwillingness to work, she said. A third aspect, or what influences decisions on disclosure, is different governing practices. So the informants representing employers gave different examples of how they work preventative in the workplaces. For example, with control of short-term sick leave for the employer to make a preventative rehabilitation plan, or health controls and drug tests that have become much more common now if you are
about to employ someone new for a position. But other governing practices is how different contracts also can be written between the employer and the occupational healthcare. So for one example, in the contract it could be stipulated that the employer needs to know from the beginning if you're seeing the occupational healthcare, and in other contracts you as an employee could have up to 3 meetings with the occupational healthcare before the employer gets to know. And a fourth example of this governing practices can be seen when the doctor from the occupational healthcare talked about how organizational changes or changes in the workplace. Nowadays, she gets much more questions to evaluate the workability of people when there is a reorganization in the workplace than she did before. And both Foster and Ross has written about this, how flexibility can be something positive in a workplace for persons with disabilities, but flexibility can also be something that makes this group even more vulnerable when the organization is changing and you're supposed to adapt to the organization. A fourth aspect was concerned with career opportunities. So whereas the representatives from the employers underlined how it was a positive thing most of the time to disclose in an employment interview, for example, in order for the employer to decide if it was possible to make certain accommodations, the informants with invisible impairments expressed much more of an uncertainty whether they would disclose in such a situation. And to disclose is relevant only if a person's workability is affected, said one of the representatives from the employers. But at the same time, they saw it as important that a person in an employment interview disclosed in impairments in order to make these accommodations and adaptations. And if an interview leads to an employment of a person with an impairment that work cannot be adapted to, this could lead to problems for the employee, one of the representatives said. She said like this: sometimes people tell at a recruitment interview, I have Asperger's, I have ADHD, and actually that is a good thing because then the recruiter can follow up with questions such as, okay, and what does that mean for you at work? Are there special things that are difficult for you? Are there special things your manager needs to think of in order to make it work for you? Because we do have laws against discrimination in this country, and you cannot deny someone an employment solely on the basis of a disability. On the other hand, if a person has a very obvious disability, which means that the work situation needs accommodation, it becomes tricky if the person doesn't tell. Because perhaps this work situation cannot be adapted, and then it will probably end with discharge one day. Perhaps the person end up with a job they didn't want to do. So it's more about oneself. And as the interviewee frames it here, the problem is if a person becomes employed but can't do the work, and becomes transferred and are not happy with that. And this way, the need to disclose becomes something more a practice that the person with invisible impairment got to gain from, according to this informant. It's a responsibility the individual has to take herself or himself. But this quote could also be understood as a strategy, I think, to avoid hiring the wrong person at the wrong place.
the informants referred to. And as they referred or framed it, it wasn't so much a problem if a person was on sick leave as if a person was in a position but couldn't do their work. So openness has been identified in several studies as an important factor in a recruitment process. But studies have also shown that it's very important about how much you disclose and what kind of impairment we're talking about, and in what way you disclose. And not being sure about this, I claim, can have an impact on people's choices if they chose to disclose or not. And the worry and insecurity about the future employer's attitude can lead to an in-lock of persons with invisible impairments, that they stay with their present employer, whether this person knows about the impairment or not. But staying at the present work can also involve assumptions by co-workers and employers that a person who has disclosed won't stay on at the place, or that they can't do challenging work and that they will soon leave. And in this study, two of the persons who had a higher position in their organizations and had invisible impairments talked about just about not getting responsibility for more difficult projects or not getting the support and accommodation that they needed. So, what can these findings tell us? Disclosure had for most of the informants meant something positive, to get understanding for their co-workers and their employer, and spare them the distress, as they said, of not being caught lying. That was their own words. However, they also talked about their fear of losing their job, of not being able to get a new job, as well as being treated different by others at work. And even though such experiences are individual, I claim that they can still show us something generally about the working life and the working life in Sweden, that although comparatively strong laws in Sweden aiming to protect the employee, persons with invisible impairments have a precarious situation or position. Not trusting that disclosure will be accepted at work can affect their career choices. And despite the privilege of passing, governing practices in different workplaces might make it harder for people to decide for whom, when, and how disclosure will take place. And this being in control of disclosure was something that was very important for the informants in the study. And just as practices in workplaces can be understood as a form of governing of the employer, the governing is also something the persons with the invisible impairment conduct over themselves, their workability and their bodies. And what I suggest is that part of this governing is to strive for normality, a normality that is difficult to live up to, as accommodation and support implies difference from others at work. And this strive to live up to normality could be understood in Dorothy Smith's very generous definition of work. She says that work is intentional, it's done in some actual place under definite conditions and with definite resources, and it takes time. So the practices of disclosure or non-disclosure could be seen as a kind of work. But also the representatives of the employers do work when they govern health and illness and disability to different practices, And when they try to avoid hiring the wrong person at the wrong place, but also when they try to adapt and accommodate to a reasonable level in the workplace, using different discourses then about what a reasonable level actually is. So using Smith's generous definition of work helps me answer the questions that Amanda Jones raises in her literature review of disclosure of mental illness. And she asks, do they generally have to work to conceal their illness from others? Or is non-disclosure usually just a form of inaction? And my answer would be, yes, they do. They do have to do this kind of work. And finally, these results are important, I think, and important insights when trying to answer what factors that influence on disclosure, non-disclosure, and also contributing to a more critical perspective, not taking stance that disclosure is something good or bad, something you should promote or not, but contributing in this more critical perspective on what disclosure can be in working.